In these difficult times of Peña Nieto and Daniel Trump, where from the power are stimulated idols, false values, and corruption, it is important to turn out our attention to moral and academical ethical values. It is for this reason, and not only because Monica is an entrañable dear friend, that I want to highlight Monica's intellectual honesty and the human values that as a Mexican woman mathematician she embodies. True passion, love for mathematics per se, diligent work, enjoyment through effort, dignity. Her wisdom for many, many years made me think in Leon Tolstoy quote about mathematicians. Pleasure lies not in discovering truth, but in seeking the truth. With you, Monica Clapp from the Institute of Mathematics.
Thank you very much, Luis, for your extremely kind introduction. And thanks for being here. I also want to thank the organizers for inviting me to participate in this celebration. It's really a great honor to be here. So let us start with mathematics. And I am going to consider that model problem, which is perhaps the simplest nonlinear PDE you can think of, simple in the sense that it involves only two data. So one of them is the domain, and I will assume that the domain is a bounded set, a bounded open set in Rn with smooth boundary. And the other piece of information is the exponent of the nonlinear term, which is going to be larger than 2, q larger than 2. So, as usual, just to make everything very clear, this delta u is the Laplace operator, as usual. Okay. So, I will be interested, of course, in existence of solutions, but more than that, I will be interested in the behavior of the solutions and on their shape. Okay, so the first thing I have to tell you is that the existence of solutions to this problem depends very strongly on the exponent of the nonlinear term. So there is a particular exponent, which is this guy here, which is defined in terms only of the dimension of the domain, which is capital N. And this guy is called the critical Sobolev exponent. And depending on whether the q is smaller than this number 2 to the star or equal to 2 to the star or greater than 2 to the star, the problem will be called subcritical, critical, or supercritical. Okay? So how does the existence depend on this exponent? Well, the first thing is, if the problem is subcritical, so if the exponent is smaller than 2 to the star than the critical Sobolev exponent, then this problem is quite easy from the variational point of view. It behaves very nicely. One can apply standard variational methods and show that the problem has infinitely many solutions. But if you take u to be larger than or equal to the critical Sobolev exponent, then this is no longer true. And in this case, the existence of solutions depends on the domain. So a first result is due to Boaschaev, and it says that if you take the exponent to be larger than or equal to 2 to the star, and if the domain omega is strictly star-shaped, which means star-shaped means that there is a point inside of the domain where you can see all of the points in the on the boundary. Okay? Then in this case, the problem does not have a non-trivial solution. On the other hand, there is quite a remarkable result due to Barry and Coron, who proved that if the exponent is precisely the critical exponent, and if the homology with CMO2 coefficients is non-trivial, then the problem has a positive solution. So if you take a ball, you won't have any non-trivial solution in a ball, but if you make a hole inside the ball, then you get a positive solution. And in fact, one expects to have many solutions, but this is not proved. And this is a very difficult problem. Okay, so I will be mainly interested here in the critical exponent problem. So why is that? So why is the critical exponent problem so interesting? Well, there are several reasons, and one of them is that it has a very rich geometric structure. So as I will show you in a while, the critical exponent problem is invariant with respect to Möbius transformations. And this makes the problem very, very natural. I mean, it appears in a very natural way. Miguel, hay lugar aquí adelante. I'm sorry. So the problem, the critical exponent, due to its geometric structure, it appears in a very natural way in problems, in important questions coming from differential geometry, like the Yamabe problem or the prescribed curvature problem. So I will tell you something about the Yamabe problem in just a moment, but there are other reasons. And the fact is, I mean, this is a variational problem, but it is not a trivial one. So the fact is that there is a lack of compactness of the variational functional, which is responsible for many interesting behavior that we will see throughout this talk. And of course, as it always happens with problems which are, on the one hand, important, and on the other hand, difficult, I mean, this has been an amazing source of new ideas. So let me recall what the Yamabe problem is and what is the relation with the critical exponent problem. Okay, so we start with a closed Riemannian manifold. So this is a smooth manifold without boundary, compact, and you have a Riemannian metric, and you can think of a Riemannian metric as having the manifold embedded in some Euclidean space, and then it inherits on the tangent space the scalar product of that Euclidean space. So the question is, when are two metrics equivalent? And equivalent here means conformally equivalent, which means that at each point, one of the metrics is a multiple, a positive multiple of the other one. And this positive multiple varies smoothly along the manifold. So in other words, it means two metrics are going to be conformally equivalent if there exists a smooth function rho, which is positive, with the property that one of the metrics is this multiple rho of the other one. And then there is a classical, a classical result, which is called the uniformization theorem. And this was conjectured by Klein and Poincaré at the end of the 19th century. And they conjectured that if your manifold has dimension 2, so if it is a surface, then every Riemannian surface admits a conformally equivalent metric of constant curvature. And this result was in fact proved by Poincaré and Courbet at the beginning of the 20th century. So the analog of this result in higher dimensions is what's called the Yamabe problem. So now we have a closed Riemannian manifold with dimension larger than or equal to 3. And we can ask the similar question. We can ask the question whether the manifold admits a metric which is conformally equivalent to the given one, such that for this new metric, the manifold has constant scalar curvature. Okay? And it is called the Yamabe problem because Yamabe gave an affirmative answer to this question already in 1960. The problem with Yamabe's answer is that his proof was not okay. So Trudinger discovered in 1968 that there was a mistake in Yamabe's proof. And Yamabe's proof worked very well for negative curvature, but it didn't work in the other cases. And this is just because the problem, the variational problem, is not compact. So he didn't take into account this lack of compactness. And then after that, Aubin was able to characterize he gave an invariant, which is called now the Yamabe invariant, and he showed that if the Yamabe invariant of the manifold is strictly smaller than the Yamabe invariant for the round sphere, then the answer would be yes. And proving this took a long time. So Aubin himself was able to prove in 1976 that the answer was yes if the dimension is larger than or equal to 6, and the manifold is not locally conformally flat. And then many years later, Schön was able to prove the other cases. So now we know that the answer to the Yamabe problem is yes. Okay, so what is the relation between the problem I posed at the beginning and this Yamabe problem? Well, it turns out that if you take this, you want to find a metric G tilde, which is a multiple of the metric G such that the scalar curvature for G tilde, which is written like this, is constant. So then you can write this rho as U to the 2 to the star, this is the critical Sobolev exponent, minus 2. And if you do so, then the scalar curvature for the metric G and the scalar curvature for the metric G tilde satisfy this equation. So you see, this is a very similar equation to the one I wrote at the beginning. I mean, only that we are now on a manifold M, and this is the Laplace-Beltrami operator. But then the Yamabe problem consists in taking this R G tilde to be constant and asking whether this problem has a positive solution. So what the theorem says is that this equation has indeed a positive solution when R of G tilde is constant. Okay. So let us go back to our original problem. So as I told you at the beginning, if I take the exponent Q to be subcritical, then this problem has infinitely many solutions. The very natural question is the following one, you see. What happens to the solutions of the problem that we know that they exist when the exponent goes to the critical one? Okay? I mean, this is, I think everyone here in this audience could ask this question, but not everybody could answer it. Huh? Okay, so these guys, Barry, Lee, and Ray, in 1995, asked this question, and they gave an answer for positive solutions. So they looked at solutions of our problem, which are positive. They take only non-negative values. And they described the behavior of the positive solutions as the exponent goes to the critical one. And what they showed is that the following two things can happen. Either the solutions of the subcritical problems converge indeed to a positive solution of the critical problem. That's one possibility. The other possibility is that they blow up. And what they did is they gave a very precise description of this blow-up phenomenon. Now, I am going to only give you a part of the result. And the part that I am going to emphasize here is that what they proved is that if blow-up occurs, then it occurs at a finite number of points in the domain. And at each point, the picture that you will see as Q goes to 2 to the star is something like this. So you see a solution, the green one, and then you see the blue one, and then you see the red one, and this is why it blows up. You see, you have the same solution, it concentrates, and it blows up. And this is what happens at each of the points, of the blow-up points. Now, the asymptotic profile of the solution is a rescaling, like this, I mean, of the so-called standard bubble. So what's the standard bubble? Well, the standard bubble is just this guy right here. It has an explicit formula. This is a constant which depends only on the dimension. And the standard bubble is up to dilation and translation, the only positive solution to the same equation, but on the whole of Rn. Okay? So if you look at the same critical equation I started with, but now you look at it on the whole of Rn, then what you see, the only positive solution is this guy. Okay? But you see, if you look at the problem on Rn, and then you take the stereographic projection, this equation that you have here is just the Yamabe equation on the round sphere. And this guy, the standard bubble, corresponds to the constant function equal to 1, say, on the round sphere. Okay? So, okay. And of course, since this is the only positive solution to this problem, one knows that if blow-up occurs, the profile, the asymptotic profile, will always be a solution to this problem. So this problem will be called the limit problem. It's called the limit problem, and I will denote it by P infinity. Okay? And this will play a very important role throughout this talk. And so, since this is the only positive solution, if you look at the behavior of positive solutions, the only thing that can happen in blow-up is that you see a profile which is the standard bubble. On the other hand, another thing that is interesting here is that the standard bubble has been profusely used as a building block to construct solutions for a wide variety of problems. So if you went to the, many of you went to this PRIMA meeting in Oaxaca, and you listened to Manuel del Pino's talk, and there you saw how he constructed solutions for, elliptic equations, parabolic equations, and so on, using this standard bubble. So I will give you here another example, okay? So let us take any domain omega. I will assume just for simplicity that the domain contains the origin. And now I will take out a little ball, a ball of radius delta, out of this domain. So I will make a little hole in the domain. And I will look at our critical exponent problem, but now in this punctured domain, okay? And, okay. So, as I told you at the beginning, Barye and Coron showed that when the homology is non-trivial, you have one positive solution. Now, the problem of multiple solutions, this is a very difficult problem. Nevertheless, there is a very beautiful result by Gemuso and Pistoia from 2010. And what they showed is that the number of sign-changing solutions to this problem goes to infinity as the size of the hole goes to zero. So if you make the hole very, very, very small, you get more and more and more solutions. And how do these solutions look like? Well, they look like bubble towers, which means you take the standard bubble, you reparameterize it, and you put a sign. So you have a positive bubble, and then you add a negative bubble, and then a positive bubble, and so forth and so on. And this is called the bubble tower. So what they showed is that the number of bubbles that appear in a bubble tower increases as the size of the hole goes to zero. Okay? And what they used to prove this result is a method which is called the Lyapunov-Schmidt reduction method that requires quite a good knowledge about this standard bubble. But since we have a explicit formula for it, it is very easy to know things about the bubble. Okay. So here another natural question is the following one. Okay, so we have the standard bubble. And the standard bubble is a solution of our limit problem, the problem in the whole of Rn, and it has been used to construct solutions. So now the question is, are there other solutions of this problem that one can use as building blocks to produce other types of solutions? Say, for example, in puncture domains like the ones of Gemmus and Pistoia. Okay? So this is the question I want to address in this talk. So the first question we have to answer is, are there other solutions to the limit problem? And the answer is yes, and this is the first solutions, sign-changing solutions, were shown, obtained by Ding, by Weiwei Ding, already in 1986. And his construction or his proof is very beautiful, you see, because it uses the geometry. So what does he do? He shows that, in fact, the limit problem has infinitely many sign-changing solutions which are invariant under the action of a group of conformal transformations, which has the property that all of the orbits of this group action have positive dimension. Remember that I told you that blow-up can occur only at points. So if we show that there are groups of transformations, of conformal transformations, whose orbits are, all of them, positive dimensional, no blow-up can occur. So this was the idea behind Ding's proof. And let me show you what were Ding's examples. So what he did is he took the stereographic projection from the n-dimensional sphere to Rn, okay? And on the n-dimensional sphere, he took linear transformations. So he considered the group OK times OM, where OK is the group of all linear isometries of RK, and similarly for OM, and K plus M is N plus 1. So one has a linear action on Rn plus 1, which induces an action on the n-sphere, and via the stereographic projection, you get a conformal action. This is not linear anymore. You get a conformal action on Rn. And what are the orbits? Well, we just have to look at the orbits on the n-sphere. And the orbits on the n-sphere are either a sphere of dimension k minus 1 or a sphere of dimension m minus 1 or a product of spheres like this. And they have, of course, positive dimension if you take K and M larger than or equal to 2. So these were Ding's examples. And then since one cannot have blow-up, one can apply standard variational methods and show that the problem has, indeed, infinitely many solutions which are invariant under the action of this type of groups, G. So the question is, can we use these solutions as building blocks? And the answer is, well, they are not likely to occur as asymptotic profiles because they are very rigid. I mean, they are constant on orbits, and the orbits have positive dimension, so they are very unlikely to occur as the concentration profiles for in blow-up phenomena. Okay. So are there other solutions? Well, yes, there are other solutions. So Del Pino, Musso, Packard, and Pistoia show that there are also solutions which look like this. So solutions which look like a standard bubble centered at the origin, and then around in a circle around the origin, you place lots of bubbles very dilated, and you get a configuration which transversally looks like this. Okay? So a bubble surrounded by a positive bubble surrounded by many negative bubbles. Now, this type of solutions do appear as asymptotic profiles in concentration phenomena. So there is a very recent result, a very beautiful recent result by Musso and Wei, where they show that they appear as blow-up profiles for supercritical problems. So there are solutions that look like this in the supercritical case, like two copies of these guys. But you see, they are sums of poggles. And I don't want poggles. I want something different. So my question is, can I produce solutions which do not look like bubbles or sums of bubbles or whatever, but which have a very different limit profile? Okay. So then, okay. So the program is to construct other solutions, other sign-changing solutions to the problem in Rn, which are suitable to be used as building blocks and which are not made out of bubbles. So this is the program. And this is what I will show you. So the first thing I will show you is how to obtain new solutions to this problem, and I will construct them by following the ideas I introduced at the beginning. So now I am going to look again at the subcritical problem, and I will look at the particular sign-changing solutions to this problem and study what is their behavior as Q goes to 2 to the star. Okay, so this is the idea for constructing solutions, which, I mean, since they are produced in this way, they are bound to be building blocks. And then, well, of course, one has to show that these new solutions occur as building blocks of solutions to related problems, say, in bounded domains or whatever. So this is the program. So following the tradition in this institute, as you already saw in the lecture of Isabel, I am going to use symmetries to produce the solutions. Okay? So we start now with a group of linear isometries, with a group, a close-up group of the group of linear isometries. And what I am going to ask of this group is that it admits a continuous homomorphism of groups to the group with two elements. And I want this homomorphism to be continuous and to be surjective. Okay? So since it is continuous and surjective, the group G cannot be connected. Okay? So let us look at a group like this with a homomorphism like this. So why do I want a homomorphism like this? The reason is that if I have a homomorphism like this, I should think of it as putting a little tag on each of the elements of the group G. So you are putting either a plus or a minus on each group element. So then if you take the orbit of a point, which is just the point, and then you apply all of the elements of the group, so this set is called the G orbit of Xi, then you can split it into two pieces. One of the pieces is you apply only those elements G such that they lie in the kernel of phi. And the other piece is you apply the elements which are not in the kernel of phi. Okay? And then you get a splitting of the orbit. So let me give you an example. So if you take G to be the group generated by the rotation of angle pi over 3, then if you take a point, okay, a point here, its orbit is going to consist of these 6 points, okay? And then if I take this phi to be minus 1 on the generator, so on the rotation that generates the group, then you will have the red part is the part G plus, and the blue points are the what is in G minus. So why do I want to split the orbits in this way? The reason is that this is a very cheap way to generate sign-changing solutions. So now I am going to look. I will assume that my domain is G-invariant, and I will look for solutions that I will call phi-equivariant solutions that have this property. U of g of x is phi of g times u of x. So in other words, if g is in the kernel, I am only saying u of gx is u of x. But if g is not in the kernel, if phi of g is minus 1, then I get here a minus. Okay? So a phi equivariant solution has a graph that looks like this. So in, in our previous example, okay, so I had that the phi of rho was minus 1, so my function, a phi equivariant function is a function that satisfies this rule for every point x. And so if it is positive here, then it is negative here, then it is positive here, and so on, and the absolute value is the same, okay? So you see the phi equivariant solutions have the feature that they are non-radial because on the same orbit they change sign, and they change sign, okay? So they change sign and they are non-radial. So looking for phi equivariant solutions is like looking for a particular kind of sign-changing solutions which are non-radial. Okay. Now, let us go back to our problem. So here we have our original problem. And as I told you at the beginning, this is a variational problem. So this means that the non-trivial solutions of this problem are the critical points of some functional which is defined on a manifold which lies inside some Hilbert space. So this guy is a Hilbert space, it's the Sobolev space of functions which are in L2 star and which have first weak derivatives in L2, okay? With the norm given by this guy here. And this manifold lies inside this Hilbert space and it looks like a sphere. It is radially diffeomorphic to the unit sphere in this Hilbert space, okay? And the functional, well, has a very simple form. It's just 1/2 of the norm square in this Hilbert space minus 1 over q times the LQ norm to the q. Okay, so this is the variational formulation. So we have to look for critical points of the functional on this Hilbert manifold. And those will be precisely the non-trivial solutions to the problem. If we now want to look for solutions which are phi equivariant, I will put a phi on this notation. And this means we are looking now for critical points of the same functional, but now on the sphere, on the Nehari manifold, which consists only of functions which are phi equivariant. So that's my variational problem. And you see, I mean, one is tempted to look for minima. Well, minima do not trivially exist because here you have a sphere, but the sphere is infinite dimensional, and an infinite dimensional sphere is never compact, no? But nevertheless, as I told you at the beginning, when Q is subcritical, then in fact, you will be able to find a minimum. So I will refer to a minimizer of this JQ on the Nehari manifold of phi equivariant functions as a least energy solution to this problem. Okay? And this exists. This is very standard in variational methods. So the question is now the same one as we asked at the beginning. What happens to these minimizers as Q goes to 2 to the star? And, okay, so let me show you. Okay, now for simplicity, I mean, I have a more general result, but I don't want to make a mess of it. So let me just assume that my group is very nice. So this means that the orbits are either fixed points or look like the group G, and that both cases occur. I will give you examples afterwards, but I will assume this. Okay, so what is the result? Well, the result says that if you take a sequence of numbers qk that go to 2 to the star from below, and a least energy solution to the corresponding problem, then this sequence of least energy solutions behave in the following ways. Either it converges strongly to a least energy solution of the critical problem, which is phi equivariant, or it blows up. So we want to see how it blows up. This is the interesting thing. So you have two chances, because I am assuming that the orbits are either G or a point. So if the orbit is G, then this UK will look like a rescaling of the standard bubble. Recall that this U is the standard bubble. So it will look like a rescaling of the standard bubble, a sum of rescalings with a sign. Okay? So these are again bubbles. Okay? This is one possibility. The other possibility is that the orbit is a fixed point. Okay? And that the point of concentration is a fixed point. And then in this case, what happens is the following thing. So what the theorem says is that there exists a least energy solution, W, to the limit problem, which is phi equivariant. And this sequence that we chose looks like a rescaling of this solution concentrating at a single point. So it looks at every point, what you see is a rescaling of this guy. Okay? But now this guy is not a bubble, because it is a solution which is phi equivariant. So I will give you a kind of picture in a moment. But what I would like to point out about this theorem is that you see hidden in this theorem, what you really have is an existence result, or rather, an existence alternative. So you see, let us assume that the group is not finite, okay? Then we can forget about this part A. So what does the theorem say? The theorem says either you get a least energy solution to the problem in the domain omega, which is phi equivariant, or you get a least energy solution, which is phi equivariant, to your limit problem. So either you have this or you have this. But now you see, this is true for every omega, which is G invariant. So let us take omega equal to the ball. The ball is convex, is star-shaped. So this cannot occur. Okay? So if you take omega to be the ball, the only possibility, and G to be infinite, the only chance that you have is B. And B says in particular, there exists a solution to the limit problem, which is phi equivariant. Okay? And this is what I am writing here. So I recall the assumptions were that G is a closed subgroup of On, which has only these two kinds of orbits, and this both cases occur, and phi is a continuous epimorphism. Then, as a corollary of the previous result, what we get is that if the dimension of G is positive, so if G is not finite, then the limit problem has a non-trivial phi equivariant solution. Okay? And these are the kind of solutions I'm looking for. So I will give them a name, and I will call them phi nodal bubbles. I mean, this is a very natural name, nothing original about that. But what I want to point out, again, is that phi nodal bubbles are non-radial, so they are not bubbles, and they are sign-changing, okay? And the other thing that I want to say is that they are different from the solutions that were found by Dean, and they are also different from those found by Delpino, Musso, Packard, and Pistoia. So these are different types of solutions. Okay, so now before I proceed, let me give you an example of a group that satisfies all of these things, okay? So that we see that the theorem has some meaning. Hmm? Okay, so in dimension 3 there are no examples, but in dimensions larger than or equal to 4 there are examples. And in order to to give you the, to show you what the group action is, I will write Rn as C2, the complex times the complex, and then times Rn minus 4. And I will write the points in Rn as Z, comma X, and well, C is a pair of complex numbers, okay? So now what's the group? Well, the group will be the group generated by the unit complex numbers acting, I mean, the group action will occur only on this Z2 part, and so the unit complex numbers just act by multiplication in the first component, and the, this other guy, tau, acts like this. So it's kind of a reflection. What is phi? Well, phi will be 1 on the unit complex numbers and will be minus 1 on this tau, which I called here rho. I don't know why, but the rho is equal to tau. Okay? Okay. So then what are the orbits? Okay. Well, if z is equal to 0, then you have a fixed point because, I mean, 0 is not, doesn't get moved by this transformation. They are linear transformations. And if z is, so the first component is different from 0, what you will see are is two circles, the union of two disjoint circles. So one of the circles lies in a plane, okay, in the plane generated by xi, okay, and the other circle lies on the orthogonal plane, which I drew here as a line because I cannot do four-dimensional drawings. Okay? So these are the orbits. So indeed, what we have is that the orbits are either fixed points or look like the group G. Okay? And this you can do in dimensions larger than or equal to 4. Okay, so using this this example, what we get is, okay, I wanted to go back. So for this particular example, we have indeed, madre mía, five nodal bubbles with of this type. Okay? Now, the next question is, can one use these bubbles to produce solutions? Okay? So well, let me tell you what we have. Okay? Let me tell you what we have. So again, these are the hypotheses on the group. I will assume that the domain now is G invariant. I will assume that it contains the origin. And now I will look at the punctured domains. So the same question as Gemmus and Pistoia considered. And the question is, can other towers, are there solutions to this problem which look like towers of nodal bubbles? Okay? So now the pieces will not be standard bubbles, but these other solutions that I just showed you. Okay. So the result that we have is the following. So this is a joint result with Jorge Falla, who is that guy sitting right there, and Filomena Pacella. And if you assume that the domain is strictly star-shaped, then what you can prove, what we prove is the following thing. If you take any integer m, and you take a sequence of deltas, delta is the radius of the hole that goes to zero, then what we prove is that there exists a solution to the problem for each delta k, a positive number L, and a phi nodal bubble, L phi nodal bubbles and sequences of parameters. Well, we prove that these solutions look like this. So they really look like towers of phi nodal bubbles. WJs are phi nodal bubbles. Now, you don't have the situation that, these phi nodal bubbles are not unique. You can have many of them, okay? we don't know how many. But then we cannot say, well, every guy in the tower is the same bubble. But what we can say is that the energy of the tower can be as large as we wish, because M is a given number. Okay? So what we say is that there are indeed towers of five nodal bubbles with energy as high as we want it. So this is what the result says. Now let me tell you what it doesn't say. Okay? And what it doesn't say is that you can indeed use these pieces, use these five nodal bubbles as building blocks, because we do not have enough information on the five nodal bubbles to use the Lyapunov-Schmidt reduction method, which is the method that uses to construct solutions. So we are not constructing them. We are obtaining them using concentration compactness arguments and some Morse index estimates. So there are these towers of nodal bubbles, but we cannot say, well, I take these pieces and I construct a solution. This is something we cannot do yet. Okay. So I am very optimistic. So this here is still a lot to do. So finally, I want to mention another type of result that we get. And you see, I showed you how to construct solutions to the limit problem. So that this bubble, this five nodal bubble. Now, can we apply the same method to other problems? Okay? So let me give you an example. Okay? So now let us look at a similar problem, which is this one here, where now this delta P is the P Laplacian, okay, which is defined this way. Okay? So if you take P equal to 2, then this is just the Laplace operator. And now this P to the star will be the corresponding critical Sobolev exponent. Okay? So let us look at this problem, which is a generalization of the limit problem we have been considering here. Okay? And well, there is a result quite recent by Shunzi and Betois, and they show that this problem, well, there is a solution which looks very similar to the one in the case P equal 2. What they showed is that this solution is the only positive solution up to translations and dilations. So again, this problem is complicated because you have the dilations, and the dilations produce blow up. So again, you have the same difficulties as in the case of the P equal 2. But now this problem is more difficult because, you see, the next question one can ask, okay, one has a positive solution, it is unique, so are there also sign-changing solutions? And the point is, you see, you cannot use Ding's approach because the P Laplacian is invariant on the translations and on the dilations, but it is not Kelvin invariant. I mean, it's not invariant under the Kelvin transform or any suitable version of it. So this was proved recently by Lindquist. So one cannot use this Ding's approach. One can also not use the Lyapunov-Schmidt reduction method because one has no idea, again, what is the linearized operator at the standard bubble. So the method of Delpino, Musso, Packard, and Pistoia also doesn't work. But our method works. Our approach works. And in fact, we proved with Luis Lopez, who's also sitting there, that using this approach, one can construct non-radial sign-changing solutions to the critical P Laplace problem in Rn. And in fact, we get a certain number of solutions using different symmetries, okay? Which one can also do in the case P equal 2. Okay. So This was the mathematical part of the talk, and there are two slides left. So the first slide has to be in Spanish, I am sorry, and then the last slide will be in English again. So, lo que quiero decir es que para mí ha sido un enorme privilegio trabajar en este instituto, pertenecer a este instituto y estar rodeada de gente tan maravillosa como todos ustedes. De veras es un regalo maravilloso que me ha dado la vida. Yo les agradezco a todos ustedes que estén aquí, les agradezco que me hayan acompañado y que me sigan acompañando en este trayecto de vida. Les agradezco que sean tan inteligentes, les agradezco que sean unos seres humanos tan maravillosos. A nuestros estudiantes les agradezco su entusiasmo, su talento. A nuestros técnicos les agradezco que siempre estén dispuestos a echarnos la mano y a filmarnos haciendo estas cosas raras. O sea, de veras, es un placer y es un honor y es un privilegio trabajar en este lugar que, como decía Luis hace un rato, es un pequeño pedazo del paraíso en medio del caos. Entonces, pues lo que dice la siguiente transparencia es un abrazo enorme, gigantesco a todos. Y finalmente, lo que quiero decir, I want to thank everyone for your kind attention, and also I want to thank all of our guests for coming here to celebrate our 75th birthday with all of us. Thank you very much. That's right. No, I guess you can do many different versions of it. I mean, what I am using here in particular is the following. I am using the fact that for the critical exponent problem, blow up occurs only at points. So this is one piece of information. Then I want to have blow up, okay? So since I want to have blow up, I have to have a fixed point. I cannot have all orbits which are of positive dimensional. But I need to have orbits that are positive dimensional in order to generate solutions. So I have to combine these things all together. But I am sure this should work in more general settings. This is just kind of the starting point. No?
Another question?
If you want to, in a sense, Carlos, the point is that this problem without any potential, without anything, is kind of the hardest one, you see? Because if you have a potential, this can help you produce solutions somehow, no? And if you look at the anisotropic equation, we also have some results for that. And those are also interesting because they help you, for example, generate solutions to the critical problem. So one can use similar ideas in the case where you have some coefficients inside your equation, some coefficient functions inside your equation. Sure.
Thanks, Monica.
Gracias.